Hello, Guardians, and welcome to Destiny Reset, Episode 41. This podcast is about anything and everything related to Destiny the game. If you enjoy playing Destiny as much as we do, you're in the right place. This reset, we dive right into the April update, rewards all around except for Cyborg, and Mr. AKA Manny G joins us to talk about it all. Hello, Guardians, and welcome. This is Arrow Knight, and here with me, Cyborg Sasquatch. How you doing, man?
Why, hello, Arrow Knight. How are you, my friend? Are you a more rewarded and more powerful Guardian?
I am, very much so. Very much so.
Yep. Glad to hear it, man. Well, we have somebody awesome with us today.
We do. It has been... too long for this gentleman to not have joined us on the show.
No doubt.
Who do we have?
We have Mr. AKA Manny G.
Manny.
Welcome. What's Manny. Up, guys? Thank you, guys. Totally appreciate being on the show.
How's it going, dude?
Going really well. Man, this week has been so awesome. Can't wait to get into all the details, but Destiny is back in a big way, so really excited.
No doubt.
Definitely so, man.
Well, if you don't know Manny is one of our powerful and fabled community administrators in the Destiny Reset podcast clan. And Manny, we'll just get into a couple things we always like to ask our guests so everyone can get to know you a little better. So tell us, man, how did you get into Destiny?
Well, I started my Destiny journey after the House of Wolves, so I did not start at the beginning, unfortunately. But that's I'd been playing. I started off gaming by playing Halo. Played Halo 1, 2, 3, loved it. And a friend of mine named Greg Pickle introduced me to a game called World of Warcraft.
And I
didn't like it at all when I first installed it. It was okay. But then I went to his house, I was hanging out with him, and he was raiding, and I saw it, and I was like, oh my gosh, this looks amazing. So I was like, we were moving some furniture and stuff, and I moved my TV, and I didn't plug in my Xbox, and I actually didn't plug in my Xbox for like years after that I started playing WoW. So, you know, just with anything, you know, kind of got burnt out, and I had some friends that were playing Destiny. And I just thought, man, I want to check something new out. So I got Destiny, and those friends, they just they stopped playing. So I was by myself, and then I started listening to your podcast. And then through Twitter, I got started talking to Joe. And then we started playing Destiny like every single day and for like months and months. So that's how it all started.
You guys played together on PS4, right? And then you both kind of made a pretty permanent switch to Xbox for a little while, didn't you?
Yeah, we started on, at that time, Joe had just got his Xbox.
Oh, okay.
So we started playing Xbox together and then moved over to PS4 and stayed there for a long time. And then he became an admin, and then I became an admin, and I just didn't have time to you know, keep playing six characters. So I just thought, you know, Joe is mostly on the PS4. I need to make a decision to better serve the community and to not drive myself crazy. So I just picked the Xbox. So I primarily play on Xbox One.
Very cool, man. We're covering all the territories.
Yeah, a great person to have on Xbox One. I'll take you, Manny. I'll take
Yeah, I would say you. I was even. I even got benefit of that when you and your crew over there dropped me in on War Priest challenge when I was not near the light level I should have been to get me that nice loot for my Xbox character.
Yeah, the Xbox guys are awesome. They're great. I love them so much, and I can't play during the day. I usually only play at night when all the kids are in bed and stuff. So throughout the day, whenever I come home and log on, they tell me all the stories of how they've met new people and carried new people to new activities. And it's the Xbox community is really awesome.
That's cool, great, man. So what is your favorite class and weapon in Destiny?
Oh man, my favorite class. I play all three classes, but dude, something about that Titan smash, dude. I just can't stop playing the Titan. And dude, I've been told so many times that I play it wrong because I use Death from Above, but dude, I love
people are pretty effective with that thing though. If you know,
dude,
how to
I
use
feel
it.
Like. Yeah, I feel like I could thread a needle like through different places and just boom, hit exactly where I want.
That's awesome. You're that guy.
I'm that guy. I love the Titan, dude. I love just skating around, shoulder charging with a shotgun. That's my gameplay, and it's just fun. And as soon as I put on Twilight Garrison, I've not had any interest in any other exotic.
Man, so I know.
Just the mobility is great. So I love the Titan. My favorite gun. It's Call of Vance's Duty. That is my favorite gun in all of Destiny. It's the it's the hard hitting, slow rate of fire scout rifle from Iron Banner.
Very cool.
Yeah, I remember that one. Nice, man. You like to punch holes, right?
Yeah.
It's awesome. Well, again, thanks for joining us, Manny. We have a very fun episode this week, guys. But before we can get into the fun stuff, you got to deal with Cyborg's geography lesson.
Yes. But we have a great one, though. We have a great one, don't we?
We got a really cool one. Bear with me. Our geography lesson of the week, he had a lot to say, and rightly so. But I tried to trim it down the best we could as he gave me permission to do. So let's jump in here. We have from Mr. Mike McLeod. I pronounced that right because he told me how, a.k.a. Nerdy Dolphins. And he is hailing from New South Wales Central Coast. And that is in, as far as I understand, Australia. As they say it. He's giving me lots of pronunciation notes here, guys. So I'm going to try to get these right. All right. Mike writes via email. G'day, boys. Nerdy Dolphins here from the beautiful New South Wales Central Coast. I'd love it if you could use this location as your geography lesson, Cyborg. The Central Coast is smack bang between Sydney and Newcastle. We say Newcastle. On the gorgeous east coast of North Southwest Australia is how you pronounce our country's name. The Central Coast comprises of a mix of beach, urban, and country lifestyles all within a half an hour end to end. We have over 22 world-class beaches. If you come to Australia on your Derp World Conquering Tour, give wanky old Bondi a miss completely and visit Terrigal or Avoca. God seriously knew what he was doing when he made those two. There are several saltwater lakes, more than a few rivers and creeks, as well as public swimming pools. Added to all this water are a lot of national parks and popular walking trails. Aussies are big on sport, and the local area has a very active surf life-saving culture that does very well at national competition in the summer. We also have local rugby league, rugby union, Australian rules football, AFL, and soccer comps in the winter. Soccer being the most played when you account for the kiddies as well. Apart from dedicated football team sports, we have very active cycling subculture from road racing to velodrome, crit, and mountain biking. The arts are also very well supported here, with quite a few musical and drama societies. I've lived on the Central Coast since I was a teenager, and whilst we love to travel the world as much as possible, this is my home. It isn't too big, not too noisy, and caters very well to many lifestyles. Wendy and I are lucky to own a house that backs onto 1,700 acres of public land that can never be built on. We wake up every morning hearing the multitude of birds telling us how wonderful this place is. It never grows old. Now, he almost forgot to tell us the most important things, which are what his favorite classes are. But then he followed up with another email that had some also really interesting information. So let's follow up here. He said, I am first and foremost an XO Warlock, still prefer Voidwalker on both Xbox One and PS4, but I have a Hunter and Titan as well. All XOs. I tried my best to make them identical, but didn't quite match them up. Maybe if we ever get transmogrification, I can fix them. One day. The reasoning for XO is that unfortunately for me and my wife and kids, I've had 30 full general anesthetic operations and countless awake ones, and I have a fair few screws and bolts, plus a good bit of metal inside of me, as well as wires in my spinal cord and a battery. I kid you not. Added to that are myriad skin, bone, and vein grafts where bits of me have been moved to other parts of my body. I can quite easily personify the man slash machine part of this game and fondly embrace my exo brethren. Sorry to ramble, boys. I just can't seem to make things short and sweet. Oh, well. Mikey, a.k.a. Nerdy Dolphins.
Wow. That's a pretty good case to run the exo.
Yeah.
Like yeah.
True exo at heart here. Mikey, thanks for the geography lesson, courtesy from the New South Wales Central Coast. Man, you sent me a plethora of information. I did read it all. It was awesome. I wish I could fit it all here. Maybe I'll the amend this.
Pictures
one
were
day.
Great.
Yeah.
Everything. Yeah, man.
Infographics and everything. It was great. So, guys, we'll have to add that to the Derp World Tour. What you think?
Yeah. Yeah. And our, however the heck we're going to get across the world,
one
we'll tackle the country first.
On our Derp jet, right?
Right, there you go.
Yeah. We should just
not
take
the RV.
Some sparrows.
There you go.
Yep, we'll take that some works. Sparrows across. Well.
Well, yeah, we are, we're going to mix it up this week, guys, due to how much the three of us have played over the last reset and how much fun we've had since the April update dropped. Mm-hmm. We are going to throw it out of order a little bit on you guys. Our main topic and our how was your reset, we're going to mesh together. But before we do that, we've got a couple other things. So first is leading into some news. We had some news this week. Just a little bit. We always like to cover hot fixes and patches. We don't normally have any hot fixes to talk about, but we actually do this week. We got one today. And we can sum that one up pretty quick, I think, guys, unless I missed something. Basically, they threw out a hot fix today, Monday, day before reset, at about 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time to give us our Sterling treasure box for logging in, right? Was that the only thing that it did?
As far as I know, yes. Well, it also fixed it moving forward.
Somebody mentioned on Twitter that they fixed the drop rate of ammo boxes. Like they weren't dropping right in PvE, but I don't know if that was confirmed or not.
Hmm. Okay, like across the board or just... Because I heard people complaining about special ammo for sure.
Well, special ammo was supposed to be dropping more frequently to compensate for the sniper rifle ammo nerfs. But it just wasn't dropping frequently enough. So I'm not sure if they fixed that with that patch. Twitter said they did, but I don't see any notes on that.
Yeah, well, hopefully they did, because that's kind of rough. They're hitting us on the PvP side. It's rough on the PvE side, not have that special ammo. anyways, that's not confirmed on Bungie's website, but let's hope Manny and Twitter is right, and we got fix on the ammo boxes. The weekly updates...
Or this week at Bungie.
Yes, I know, man. It's been too long. It's so hard to not.
It's hard to break those habits. I know.
It'll always be the weekly update to me.
The weekly update.
Yes, in my heart. You can't change that, Deej.
Can't change it. They did, though.
Yeah, they did. All right.
What do we have in there, man?
You know, kind of some of the usual, hey, patting ourselves on the back. We drop the patch, hooray, you know, here's some pictures, which they
pictures
deserve.
Of guardians in the community.
Yep, cool stuff. Really, I guess there was only two substantial things of note in this week of Bungie, in my eyes. They mentioned some of the issues that people are having. Clan tags not appearing in game was one. And so there is a fix for that. If you've noticed that your clan tag is not showing up, go to Bungie.net, use the repair clan feature. Or I think it's repair.
Has that always been there?
No,
has
that I think always been there? I think okay. I think it's new.
Okay.
I've never seen that before.
Hey, I didn't think I had, and then I read that and I'm like, well, I wish I would have known that forever ago, unless it wasn't there.
Yep. And I don't know if that's for anybody that's in the clan, or if you have to be a administrator or moderator in the clan. But either way, if you can't do that yourself, if you're in derp, let us know. We'll help you.
Very much.
Other fun things they mentioned, some people got really confused with the vault upon logging in, but you to see your third pages, you have to actually fill it up to a third page. People are like, I can't page over to the empty third page, but you've got to have enough stuff in there to move into that third page.
Was it like that when we got two pages?
I remember. Think
it almost had to. Yeah.
I remember having to fill it up to see.
Okay. Yeah, I totally forgot about that because I went in there. I had already read those things and I knew what I had to do, but I went in there and I was like, yeah, you can't click over until you force a piece of gear or a weapon in there, and then you can.
Yep. A few other things worth mentioning, like we did, players are reporting less ammunition than expected, dropping in specific PvE encounters, and they're looking into that. Universal remote is decrypting from special weapon engrams. That's not supposed to happen. Here's a great one. I just love this one. Ghosts are dropping as rewards for nightfall strikes with lower light than expected. A fix is being planned for a future deployment.
Those ghosts, man.
At what point are we being trolled, guys? Like, honestly, I'm not
coupled with the nightfall. I mean, it is almost trolling.
I got a ghost for my first nightfall.
I haven't ran. That's about the only thing that I haven't ran this week is a nightfall. I'm going to try and knock it out tonight.
I laughed and then I stopped laughing. It's like, this isn't funny anymore.
Well, I thought it was weird too. They also mentioned that year two Prison of Elders exotics, Drake's Promise, Queenbreaker's Bow, and Lord of Wolves may be earned by completing Prison of Elders challenge mode activities. That you can't get them from the blueprints anymore. I've heard some people chatting about that. If you've already gotten them, why we have to get them again?
Yeah, and we didn't know if that was on purpose or if that was a bug. But apparently, it's on purpose.
Yeah.
Apparently so. That's kind of disappointing because I really wanted to buy that Dreg's Promise.
Mm-hmm.
And
I never got that one. Yeah, the only one I got was Lord of Wolves.
Yeah. Oh well. Last one, Cryptarch rank up packages are granting year one engrams. That's an interesting one. I don't know how that happened.
Yeah, I saw that.
Somebody in party last night was like, I just got like a level 100 blue. And I was like, did you just rank up your Cryptarch? Yeah. Yep. That's happening.
Imagine if we could just go back in time for a day or so and decrypt blue or purples and get a downgrade back down to a blue or a green. Those days were kind of painful.
That was weird. Yep.
If we could fast forward from those days to this patch for a day or two and see where we would be many, many months ahead. It's a whole nother world.
See, that's where all the hate comes from. Nobody likes Raul because he gives you like greens for your purples.
Yep. I don't think people ever get past that. The trust is gone. And now he's just trolling us again, you know? So past all these little bugs, which, you know, nothing super major here. Okay. Just little stuff. To wrap it up, they said, what's next? They said there's an update cooking up for the fall. And they'll show us more later on this summer. So hopefully
E3.
Yeah. You guys excited?
Let's hope so. Yeah, I am. I'm excited, but that's a bit too far away. I'm still using all my excitement for this April update.
Yeah. Well, summer's about you know, E3's 2 months away.
So yeah, I know it's closer than you think. Yeah. Yep.
So I'm pumped. I'm ready.
I tweeted Deej and Cosmo and them this week and asked them, told them the movie of the week's great, but in addition to that, they should do a short like spree of the week, just like a 30-second or less kill spree that somebody had. I thought that would be pretty cool to include in the like an exceptional kill spree, you know, something. Yeah. Something that's pretty cool.
That'd be a good one.
But I didn't hear anything back.
So. Keep trying.
Not even, I would watch that.
Yeah.
So. We got a companion update that dropped also the same day as the April update, I think, on 4/12. Mm-hmm. Basically, that was just full of little tweaks and bug fixes, I think, responsive stuff and iOS-specific stuff and Android-specific stuff. Nothing too crazy. I got to say, this past week, I've been using that app more. I know we talked about it a little bit, I think, on the last show or the show before that. But, man, yeah. The new app is unbelievable. The very first screen, when you can look at all three of your characters and you just flat out have right there in front of you checked mark activities that you've done already.
Yeah, it's good.
It's so user-friendly, man. It's so cool. I love it. Yeah. I mentioned this before, but we really, at least I'll speak for myself, I take this app for granted because I'm definitely using it more now than I did before. But just playing The Division, the little that I have, I haven't played it since this update came out for Destiny, but having no companion app and then coming back to Destiny and just jumping on here, even being on my Destiny companion app while I'm playing The Division, it's like, man, this is so nice to have alongside the game.
Yeah.
Yeah, stuff. I love it. It helps me keep track of all my weapons and everything. And yeah, The mm-hmm. Division, they really, I think they kind of dropped the ball with not having a good app to go with the game.
Right. Yep.
Yeah, you would expect to see that too, because Ubisoft is usually pretty savvy with that type of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, and Manny, you mentioned in the Discord, we may forget about this by the time we get to the main topic, but we can even use the app as a way to quote unquote log in to get our Sterling treasure at the Postmaster, right? You were kind of telling me that before the show.
Yes. They did mention, because the fix that they had today would make it so that you could go to the Postmaster now and get your Sterling treasure box. But they said on Twitter, all you got to do is inspect your character on the website or on the companion app, and that will send that Sterling treasure box to your Postmaster.
That's awesome. Yep.
So yeah. So I assume this is something that will work going forward too. So if you're going to be on vacation for a week somewhere and you don't want to miss that box, just check out your dudes on your companion app.
Yeah.
Yes, that's so, I guess I didn't really think about this until you were telling me that, but basically if you do that and then you're on vacation, like you said, and you don't log in for another week, and then the next week you log in, you should have two of them sitting at your Postmaster. It shouldn't like overtake the other one you had, I wouldn't think, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that.
Another thing they did with the companion app is they added in the leaderboards, which I really like. Clan leaderboards, and then I think you can also see like leaderboards among just your friends too. So like if I go to a specific activity, take for instance, I think the raid, it'll pull up like, I think this is in progress. Trying to find this on the app while we're talking. Somewhere in here though, you can see where you stack up against a lot of your friends and stuff, and I thought that was kind of cool too. I was like browsing through, I'm like, oh, I'm fourth in this, I'm 43rd in this, I need to do better here.
Yeah, it's always cool to compare with your friends for sure. The rest of the derp fam and see where we're at.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I know you had some other news. you had in there.
Actually, and I dropped this in. I didn't even read the whole post about this, and I hope you guys can fill in the blanks. But basically, there's possibly, unless it's been debunked already at this point, but there's possibly a little mini game going on inside of Destiny right now, right?
Apparently, referring to the ARG.
Yeah, like people, they were receiving, what was it, messages on the actual Bungie website from a user. Is that right?
Yes.
Tell us more about it, Cyborg, if you know more.
Yeah, so, okay, this is where it started. Where the weirdness started was there was a post on Reddit about... I don't remember the exact time span, but it was a very, very short time after the patch dropped Tuesday morning. And it basically explained that there was a ghost, a new ghost shell that you could find in the Prison of Elders, like, you know, where you drop down through the treasure room?
Right.
And... it was up for a very short time and then they deleted it. And so people were like, well, this is kind of weird because this is not enough time for someone to have gotten to that content when this dropped and go find that ghost and then put that post up. So like, this is maybe a Bungie employee, you know? So, but that's kind of an unrelated thing. Then later on that day, people started getting really cryptic messages from somebody else, like I guess with a different name, not the same username, but about the content. Like some of it was done in the form of like a Rasputin transmission. Some of it was in Latin. Some of it was kind of riddle oriented. It was really strange and cryptic, you know, and so people are starting to pick it apart, trying to figure out what they're trying to say, start messaging the person. They're replying back with some of the stuff that they had written. I don't know. It was like a whole thing. So everybody's like, oh man, it's an ARG or some of Bungie's doing this. And there was something in Latin saying, the preferred date is September 20th. So people are saying, oh, that's when the new, you know, patch is going to drop or whatever, you need the content, blah, 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 blah. Well, unfortunately, Cosmo found it and was like, nah, this isn't us, just a fan having fun. So I was getting excited. I was like, this is kind of cool. I'm going to keep an eye on this. And then Cosmo was like, no, that's not us.
So it has been then. Man, you even made that intense for me until that last little sentence.
Man, I was getting excited.
I got you guys excited. And I did it was like living nice job of explaining what was even being said. But
so Cosmo confirmed that it's nothing. That
yeah.
Nothing
if it was still going on, because, you know, I love mystery. If it was still going on, I would have done a better job with that. But it's not a real thing. So it's somebody just having a good time.
It's funny because I saw it on Destiny Reddit and I pulled it up and it was this long post and I'm like, it was one of those that was just like, man, yeah. I can't read this right now. I got to read it later.
Yeah, there were several posts and people were going through and deciphering what was going on, what was being said and stuff. And then it got quiet pretty quick after Cosmo debunked.
Well, you know, that's what's cool is... they, you know, with things like the spindle challenge, the daily and stuff like that, like you can just never know. And that's a little bit different. But like when an update drops like that, hopefully Bungie style, we've got just a couple little things that we don't know about yet. But then it's like, well, it was a free update randomly in April to probably keep us busy until the fall. So who knows if we got anything like that? Because I know, didn't they... I heard confirmed that the unreleased exotics actually aren't in the armory anymore. If you search them, it says they're classified.
Yeah, they have either removed them or obfuscated them.
Right.
Bad news if you wanted to see that astrocyte verse like I did.
Right.
Too bad. So sad.
Well, hopefully we've got a couple surprises. Random.
Yeah. You never know.
Something comes up here and there between now and fall. Sure,
maybe we'll see SRL again.
Yeah, it's going to say something like that again, surely. Yeah, which is still unknown. We haven't confirmed whether Iron Banner's next week either with this patch dropping, I don't think. Yeah, no, they were talking about that in Discord earlier.
It should be. I mean, they've never skipped an Iron Banner, have they?
Did they just recently for the first time? Weeks
at some point.
But that's it, yeah.
Yeah.
I would be excited if it was next week. I mean, I feel a little overwhelmed because we have so many things to do now, but I'd be fine with it. Anyways, we'll get into all that fun stuff for the main topic. We have a surprise this week. Yes. We kind of teased this a few episodes ago, but we can't say exactly how often these will be, probably every few weeks or so rotating. We'll do what we can. But this week, we have a little nice, sweet little segment from our friend Them's Tattoos.
Yeah.
It's a little segment he coined as Tattoos Tickets. And he's basically, every time we fit this into the show, when he provides it for us, he's going to give you guys some pointers on the crucible and some tactics and some things that he kind of notices and things he does, and hopefully will help you guys out in your crucible gameplay. Cyborg, you got anything to add on it, man?
No. Well, keep in mind, first foremost, Tattoos recorded this a couple weeks ago for us, and we weren't able to get it in the show yet. So some of what you're about to hear is pre-patch.
Right.
But
right.
The fundamentals of what he is trying to convey here is awesome knowledge. So that being said, enjoy Tattoos Tickets with our friend Them's Tattoos. You've heard it here first.
It's Them's Tattoos. What's up, Derp fam? This is Tattoos Tickets. That's right. This is the surprise you guys have all been waiting for. I've been waiting a long time for it. I'm really looking forward to getting into some stuff. So, the plan is, hopefully, over the next couple of weeks, I'm going to be checking in with you guys, giving you some tips and tricks for the Crucible to hopefully improve your game, and hopefully just open up some discussion, talk about some of the things that are going on in the Crucible. We're going to be seeing some changes come April 12th, I believe. Looking forward to that stream on the 6th, hearing about what those changes are going to be and what we can look forward to. So, a little housekeeping. I want to let everyone know, and I haven't even talked to Arrow and Cyborg about this, but I will be at DestinyCon this year. I've made plans, opened up my schedule. I'm going to drive all the way down to Tampa and hopefully see some of the Dirt Fam there. And I have one more surprise for you, Cyborg, and for you, Arrow. If you guys are able to make it down to DestinyCon, I'm going to be bringing a couple of gifts, a couple of paintings that I did. I'm looking forward to taking some of my artwork down and sharing it with our wonderful leaders. So hopefully that's enough incentive to get you guys down there. I know it's a bit of a drive for you all too. It's looking like it's going to be about 14 hours for me, but I can't wait. It's going to be a great time. If you guys don't know what DestinyCon is, Google it. It's going to be a good time. Goth is putting on a big convention for the community, and I think it's awesome that our community, once again, is basically supporting itself. We reach out and do these things. They did one last year. I wasn't able to go, but looking forward to it. So let's get into it. This week, we're going to be talking about knowing what you can and can't do in the Crucible. What I mean about that is understanding your subclass, your weapon loadout, your movement, everything that you can do, and consequently, everything that you can't do. So, one of the interesting things to me in competitive Destiny is that people tend to be known for their subclass. So, for example, AE Gabriel. AD Gabriel isn't just an exceptional player, he's the best Titan skater you'll ever watch. Lumi isn't just a great player, he's the slipperiest Night Stalker in the game. I understand that a large portion of this is based on the fact that Destiny typically polarizes people to a certain class just because of the lore and the style of the classes. As I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, I gravitated towards the Titan because of the lore of the Titan, the style of the Titan. But aside from that, what I realized pretty quick when getting into the competitive play is that it goes much farther than preference of style or lore. Gabriel plays a Titan because he knows that no other subclass can move that quickly around the map. No other subclass has a movement like the Striker Titan. Lumi plays a Night Stalker because he knows that no other subclass has an evasive maneuver like Shadestep. He knows that no other subclass can get out of a sticky situation like a Night Stalker can. I bring this up because these choices are made based on what you can do, and more importantly, in my opinion, what other people can't do. Understanding your movement and how your neutral game works will improve your game. Understanding this will also give you the other half of the puzzle. It'll help you understand what your opponents can and can't do. If they're a Night Stalker, you have to know as a Sun Singer that they have the potential to be able to shade step out of your firebolts. So you need to catch them maybe at a little bit more of an opportune time with those firebolts to be able to actually tag them. So once you have a grasp on the popular subclasses and how they work, you'll be able to make an informed decision on what subclass you want to be known as. So that's the overall idea. Let's get a little bit more literal about it. What's my favorite PvP subclass? As I said before, I really enjoy the Hunter Blade Dancer the most in the Crucible. Quick Draw is a perk that unfortunately I've gotten used to now because I've been playing it so much lately that it just makes all of the other subclasses feel clunky and slow. I wasn't really a fan of this subclass in year one because of how ridiculously overpowered Blink was and how the super was so hard to shut down. Admittedly, now the super is somewhat broken because of the hit detection, but hopefully they'll straighten that out in the future and Blade Dancer will be in a good place again. Because I think the changes that they made to Blink really made a lot of sense, and we'll talk about Blink a little bit later. I know how to use their grenades really well. The skip grenade tracks so aggressively and over such a great distance that it's a great way to either get some good damage on somebody that's bunkered down somewhere or to chase somebody out of a rabbit hole. The backstab procs as long as you're in the air, allowing for the front stab or behind the person to get the actual backstab for the one-hit melee. A lot of people don't really understand why they get killed from the front with the backstab. I noticed this early on in year one, and it's kind of just a weird Destiny thing, but there used to be a bounty for getting kills from behind, and I started to realize that if I jumped up in the air, the game considered me behind whatever was in front of me. So if you're trying to get that dirty one-shot backstab, just do a little hop. As long as your feet are about chest height from them, the game will assume that you're behind them and give you the proc on the backstab more often than not. So I have to know going into a game that I'm running a hunter that can't turn off tracking grenades like the firebolts. So making a slippery getaway is a little bit harder as a Blade Dancer, but understanding that lets me know how to engage and disengage from different encounters. So I'd like to go over a couple of the other popular subclasses in PvP right now, and just a quick rundown on what perks you should be running if you're running those subclasses. Also a few tips on understanding what you can and can't do with that subclass, and how that should affect your match. Start with the Striker Titan. The perks for this class haven't changed much throughout the life of Destiny. This class has always been consistent and effective, and right now, I believe it's the best Titan subclass. There are some advantages to the Sunbreaker, but overall, I think you're going to get the most out of your equipment and your neutral game in the Striker subclass. You should be running lightning or blinding grenades depending on the map. Map awareness is always going to be a huge deal in the Crucible, and understanding a map that's maybe better for blinding grenades than lightning grenades might give you that little bit of an edge in those sweaty matches. So if the map has a large outdoor area and no choke points, there's not really any advantageous places to put a lightning grenade, so I would go with blinding in those maps. One of those maps, for example, might be Firebase Delphi to a certain point. There are a couple of choke points that you can cut off with that. But more or less, the really wide open maps. One extreme example could be something like First Light or Skyshock. And as far as the jump, you should be using better control. They added a little bit to Catapult, but it's really, really not worth it. You should always be using better control every time. PvE, PvP, doesn't matter. It's the best jump in the game, in my opinion. As far as the super goes, I use Shockwave for 3v3s and Death from Above for 6v6. I'm not crazy about Aftermath. You'll get a couple of cheeky kills every now and then, but more often than not, they're going to be postmortems, which you want to try and stay away from if you're trying to improve your game. For melee, I use Discharge, but there's not really any standout option in the melee perk tree. Ability modifiers, you should be using Transfusion. Melee kills typically aren't done when you're full health, so that immediate health regen will keep you in the game a lot longer. Second modifier, I've been using Juggernaut lately. Shoulder Charge is great for the one-hit melees and movement, but Juggernaut helps me make safer pushes. Juggernaut's especially good when you need to make an approach through a room that you know a very competent opponent sniper is watching diligently. A lot of times that's why you'll see streamers and other popular PvP players using Juggernaut in sweats, because they know that if the other person on the team is sniping, they're very good with that sniper. So they want that extra defense as far as pushing into a room. Moving on to Blade Dancer. It's pretty obvious here. Backstab, you're going to want for the melee for the one-hit kills. Skip Grenade's really the only grenade worth using in the subclass right now. Hungering Blade and Razor's Edge is what I go for the super. Since the hit detection's sort of off on Blade Dancer, you really need that Hungering Blade because you're going to be taking a lot of damage before you're able to get in and get the kill. Razor's Edge is also really good because it catches people by surprise. They will be backpedaling, trying to put distance between you and them to get a couple of more shots in. You can land and throw a Razor's Edge at them and they won't see it coming. The one thing I like to talk about here is Blink. I don't use it. It's just not good anymore. I would recommend using Increased Control Double Jump if you're running a Blade Dancer. This will allow you to make very tricky aerial moves. I would recommend checking out Ramblin's YouTube video, one of his many 1v3 endeavors. He was on, I believe it was Blind Watch. Look for the maneuver that he uses to get away from a Storm Trance. It's some of the best things ever. Like, that match was amazing. He got a we ran out of medals in a 1v3 in Trials of Osiris. And that one juke that he does on the Storm Trance, it just go watch it. It's amazing. The biggest reason I use Double Jump over Blink is because I can still fire my gun in the air when using Double Jump. Typically that gun is Last Word or Mida, and both of those have very good in-air accuracy. Moving on to the other popular Hunter subclass, the new one, the Night Stalker. It's something that a lot of people have gotten really comfortable with, and it's a great PvP class. This class also is somewhat obvious in the current meta. Again, I would suggest Double Jump over the other two options because you have a lot more control than you do with Triple Jump. You also get a lot more height out of the Double Jump, and that really throws people off, especially someone that's being aggressive with a shotgun. The grenades, I bounce back and forth between Void Wall and Vortex. Both have their own purposes. It's kind of like lightning grenades and blinding grenades. Depending on the map, whatever I'm feeling comfortable with, I'll use. As far as the melee, of course, you're going to want the Advenom smoke bombs. It makes for that amazing wombo combo. It's one of the strengths of the subclass. It makes any 1v1 situation infinitely easier in your favor. For the super, use Black Hole. Every time, all the time, 3s, 6s, doesn't matter. Quiver is going to get you killed because you spend too much time frozen in midair during that long animation. And the tracking hit detection on the arrow is terrible more often than not. So use Black Hole when you do, and use it when you're not being shot at. The super cannot be reactionary because of how slow it is. The animation takes long, the impact shot doesn't typically kill, and the actual tether doesn't lock on fast enough. This means this can't be a panic super. It's not Fist of Havoc. Place it on the ground, at the end of a hallway, or on a wall so you know you're in a safe position when the enemy team is either pushed up too far and is caught in the tether, or they back way off. Either way, it's a win. Use Shade Step and Lockdown. Keen Scout is a great perk, but it's really not worth giving up your exotic armor slot for Graviton Forfeit. Shade Step's a must in PvP. It's amazing. It's a great maneuver to get away from things. It's a great maneuver to push with a shotgun. It's just overall one of the best neutral game perks right now. Sunsingers. Now, you guys know, not a fan of Warlocks. Not a fan of this Sunsinger class. I personally play Stormcaller. I think it's a really fun subclass. Personally, I'm not going to get on my Warlock if I don't have a choice, but, you know, he's there. He has the Trials bounties. He can get me the 50 legendary marks every weekend. So, anyways, Sunsingers. It's another build that hasn't really changed since the launch of Destiny, similar to the Striker Titan. Use Firebolts, obviously. That's pretty much the only advice you need for this subclass. One small tip to make these bolts even more busted is to try and pop the person once or twice with a high-impact primary, like a hand cannon or a high-impact scout rifle. And you want to do this before the grenade even lands, because if you get that one or two shots before they can react to your grenade, they're going to burn out from the Viking Funeral and the Touch of Flame. Always use those perks, speaking of them. You don't really want to use any other modifiers. None of them are really worth looking into. No other subclass in this game has a grenade that powerful. Use it. I said it. I'm giving you permission. Just do it. You won't be able to sleep at night. Obviously, you want the overshield from the melee because it's busted. In Trials of Osiris, use Fireborn, and everything else, use Radiant Skin. If I'm ever seeing someone run Sunsinger in sweats and they're running Fireborn, I love it, because I promise you, I will rip your face off as soon as you stand up every time. Use Radiant Skin and sweats. They make much more effective pushes when you're playing against competent people and they're keeping an eye on your orb. That Fireborn is so easy to shut down. So, now for a couple of quick tips for using your neutral game to benefit your team. If you're a Hunter Night Stalker, play aggressively. Stand in those grenade hallways you usually avoid, because you can shade step out of most grenades and you're going to end up making the enemy team waste a lot of valuable resources. If you're a Striker Titan, be aggressive. You can move faster than anyone else in this game. Make use of that. That doesn't mean you have to shotgun. Use your speed to get to that sniper lane first. It will benefit you. Arrow does this a lot when he's on a Striker Titan. I can trust that he's going to get to that lane before anyone else is, and when he does, he's going to be looking for heads to take off. Now, if you're a Sunsinger, or really any Warlock, be supportive of your teammates. Make sure you're communicating when you're using your busted-ass grenades so that your teammates can help you push that advantage. Typically, the Warlock subclass is great for support because they have such good neutral game. They can toss those grenades, they can get those hand snipes if you're doing Stormcaller whenever you make the push. But more often than not, they don't really have the movement speed or the evasiveness to be an aggressive subclass, although I have seen some very effective flame shield shotgunning Sunsingers. But that's just my advice. So, understand how your neutral game makes you different from your teammates and your opponents. Then, exploit that difference to the best of your ability. Thank you all for listening, and I will catch you on the Crucible, Dirt Fam.
Tattoos tickets this week.
Yes.
You had some great tips for all of the classes. Excited to hear that Jordan's going to be at DestinyCon.
Oh, that's awesome, man.
Yeah. We still got to square up our plans, but we are working hard on that, buddy. I promise you that we will try to be there.
Yeah, I hope we can make it. And I hope we kind of talked about this a little bit, but at some point in the future, we may throw up a little channel on Discord so that we can figure out who all in the Derp fam is going to try to make it and possibly definitely make it, so we can have a little mini, what I call the Derp Fam Fest.
Yeah, no doubt.
Inside of DestinyCon. That would be so cool.
Fam Fest 16, baby.
That'd be so fun, man. But definitely more tattoos tickets to come, guys.
Yes.
If you haven't played with Them's Tattoos in the Crucible or Trials, he's a beast. So I hope his stuff, his pointers work out for you guys. It's good stuff.
Yep. Obviously, no love for the Warlocks. I will I'll talk with Tattoos about that, you know.
Maybe
another time. But he gave me permission to use firebolts, but you know what, Tattoos? I sleep just fine at night when I use my firebolts. So,
dude, we'll get into this in the main topic, but I just got to throw it out right now in case I forget it. In Trials this weekend, two times in one passage, we went up against Triple Sun Singers, and it is still painful. That's all I'm going to say.
Man.
All right. Yeah, sorry.
I bet it was. All right. Well, this all being wrapped up, let us get into the fun stuff this week, guys. The main topic, what's it called, Arrow?
2.2.0 and chill. AKA, and chill. How was your reset?
How was your reset 2.2.0?
There you go. Very nice. So I have been so anxious to record with you guys. And it's Monday night. This is the first time we're recording the night before release in like 3 or 4 weeks. And I'm glad because we got so much playtime in. But I have been like I can't wait to talk to you guys about this stuff and see how you feel about everything we've played. But let's jump right into story and the new strike and quests and stuff. Cyborg, what'd you think, man? Did you jump right in?
Yeah. I jumped in there, got the, the quests and the like from Mr. Varix. Since I'm on Xbox One, I don't have any quest line from Petra. I don't know when that starts, when it ends.
She always gives us exclusive quests.
Yeah. But anyways, okay. Shortest story mission ever, first of all. Is there a shorter story mission in any other? I think there may be one that I can think of at the beginning of Vanilla Destiny, but you get a little introduction to the new Taken boss. What's this guy's name again? Does anybody remember?
Malak. I forget because they confirmed it on the reveal stream. They said this is how you pronounce it, but I don't
I think
remember
it was
what
Malak.
They said. Malak, maybe.
Manny, do you know?
That sounds right.
Malak.
Okay, good.
You're both right.
I think I said it wrong at first.
No, so we're fighting Malak, right?
Clarify something for me real quick. So I got that exclusive quest from her. That one of the quests was like 5 different layers. Was that not the shared quest? Was that the exclusive quest?
Yes, that was the exclusive
one. Oh my gosh, that was the exclusive one?
Congratulations.
Man, I have layers.
Yeah, the other one was very short then. That's crazy.
What did you have to do? Tell me the layers. I'm so jealous.
Well, man, I ran through it so fast, I hardly even remember, dude. That was a week ago. Okay. But I just know there was 5 steps because I was just trying to get through it, dude.
What'd you get?
I can't even tell you. I think on that one, what did you get for the quest that you did on Xbox?
The sword.
The sword. Okay, I got the, it was the Sparrow.
The
exclusive Sparrow.
Yeah, that's the PS4 one then.
Yep. So, I mean, it's a Sparrow. At least.
Yeah, I don't care.
And if
it
makes you.
The fact that you can have it and I can't.
If it makes you feel any better, I still don't have the Zen Meteor. So, yeah.
Good. That does make me feel better.
And I got excited this week. I'm remembering all this stuff now. I was like, oh, yeah, I have a special Ingram setting on my character, just waiting. What if I get that new exotic? And then I remembered it was on my Xbox character. That's not gonna.
You gotta come over next week and decrypt that.
Yeah, not gonna.
It won't be that though.
It's not gonna be that. Nope. Anyway, all
right.
Sorry.
So we're fighting Malak, right? But my favorite moment from this story is the ghost dialogue. You guys know what I'm talking about?
I think so, but elaborate.
What did he say?
Well, Varix is like, don't capture him. I want him for the Prison of Elders. And your ghost is like, well, capture him. Whatever happened to kill them back? Do you guys remember this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love getting some.
That was
some,
amazing.
You know, comedic relief back in there, man.
He did say capture him.
Yes. So once again, we're capturing a bad guy. And I don't know. What did you guys think of this new strike?
Did you get a chance to play it, Manny?
I did not get a chance to play it.
It's the Nightfall, right?
I had too many things to do.
Okay. Yeah, see, I had a choice to run Challenge of Elders for the first time with Terry and Davis or do the new strike. And they both said it was pretty difficult, and I was kind of trying to knock out several things, so I chose not to do the Nightfall yet. So it sounds like you ran it, Cyborg. Okay. What'd you think?
Yeah, I've run it a few times now. The strike by itself, like the non-Nightfall version, is on par with the more difficult strikes, but not the most difficult. It's not like Undying Mind, pain in the butt.
I forgot, you know? I did run the normal version of it. I'm sorry, just not the Nightfall.
Yeah.
Anyways, go ahead.
I was about to say, you must have, because you had to go through the quest line, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, the main thing is, you know, you just control the adds and DPS them. The first time we did it, we DPS the boss so fast that I didn't even realize what all the different strike mechanics were. We just killed the guy. the Nightfall version is pretty tough. We'll get into that later, though.
That sounds good, man.
You guys like this new sword we got? The special Taken sword?
It looks pretty awesome on your back. It looks pretty cool.
That's about it.
Yeah.
That's about it. Yeah, I like how it looks, but I've not put in the work to get it yet.
Yeah. I just wish it had a an RT special attack like the exotic swords.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't ever use a legendary sword, so I'm not used to just having like a slash with my sword. I'm used to being able to do something special with it. But it is great against.
Well, it's on par with the other legendary swords, right? They don't have any special attacks, right?
Right. Just the elemental effect to it. So the new one, it does void damage. So you got that going for you, which is nice.
And it. If nothing else, it drops at 320 if you do your quest right off the bat. So,
yep.
Yeah.
So I actually did it on my second warlock, and I took the extra sword and I put it into my dark drinker. So nice. I got my dark drinker up to 320. Avoid exotic sword. Yeah.
Very nice.
Yep. So, pretty short quest. You know, the other part of the Varix quest is doing the PoE stuff, but there's not really much behind it, nothing really unique. It's just like, hey, go play this thing. Okay, I played that thing. Okay, go play this thing. Okay, cool, you're done. Mm-hmm. So, not much
of a quest. Yeah, it's very, very easy to get on that bandwagon of, man, there's just not a lot of content here. But I think, of course, everybody remembers that it's free, but I think what's happened with the quality of life stuff in this patch, which we'll get into all of it in this main topic, is the shining point of all this.
That stuff definitely outshines what they did with this first thing we're talking about here. So I don't want anybody to mistake that I'm salty or displeased. just giving an honest review of this particular part of this patch.
Never. Well, what do you guys... Okay, moving right into Prison of Elders. So I'm still trying to figure out myself. I ran the 41 for the quest, and then I did Challenge of Elders 3 times, enough to get the weekly bounty completed. And I'm trying to decide how valuable the replayability of the level 41 Prison of Elders is. Because you can... You don't get to the chest room in the Challenge of Elders. It's all about just killing the bosses, getting that bounty complete. And from what I understand, exotic engrams without 3 of coins can drop from the bosses in Challenge of Elders, is what I read. And in the 41, basically the point is to farm the chest at the end. Is the replayability there for the 41? I mean, farming that chest at the end and not needing keys seems awesome, but can you still get an exotic and a queen's weapon, possibly one or both from that chest?
I did 41 one time, and it took like two or three times longer than the Challenge of the Elders, and I got right. like a three of coin, or not a three of coin, but a strange coin and some motes, and that was pretty much it. Like I didn't
from the 41.
Yeah, the 41 was wow. it was it took so long and I didn't really get anything. Yeah.
Hmm. I did get a Queen's Weapon. I think I got the rocket launcher. But
nice.
I mean, for me, like, I want to play the 41 to farm for the chest at the end, but you're right. It takes, which, you know, everybody's talking about how easy the setup for Challenge of Elders was this week, that we anticipate it to be harder in the coming weeks. But yeah, it was taking like 5 minutes if you just melted the bosses in Challenge yeah. of Elders versus the five different steps in the 41.
Yeah, the 41 Prison of Elders is just normal Prison of Elders. I mean, it is what it's been for as long, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So the challenge is what's different. And I personally don't see a big reason to go into 41.
I mean, maybe they should guarantee an exotic from the chest or something. Because, I mean, it takes, 30 minutes to complete the 41 probably?
Yeah, it takes a while. Yeah.
Yeah.
Something somebody pointed out to me was the 41. If you do that before you do your heroic strikes, it actually gives you the marks in the legendary engram that you would normally get from your first three heroics.
Oh, really?
So, yeah, if you want to do that as opposed to doing a strike in the heroic strike playlist, you'll get those same bonuses from the 41 instead.
I
see a value for that there because not only do you get that guaranteed stuff, but then you also will get your chest stuff, you know, at the end.
Right.
Which, like, if you're farming, like, if you need strange coins or motes, like, that's a good value for you there, you know?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But I've done a few extra ones just to, like, wait on people or burn time, and I didn't get anything significant from those. Like, I actually got, like, blue level gear out of the Queen's chest. I was kind of disappointed.
Wow.
Yeah.
I wish I almost think they should do like a guaranteed exotic from that chest to give us more of a reason to farm that level 41.
That might maybe be a little too much.
We'll have to, yeah, but I mean, think about how long it takes. That's more than popping a three of coins. You get a exotic engram from three of coins way more often than the time it takes to run the 41.
You know? Yeah, but do you get a guaranteed exotic from running a heroic strike?
Yeah, true. But that, I mean, it takes a minute, you know. Okay, let's talk about Challenge of Elders. How many times did you guys run that this week? Did you run it just enough to get your bounty done?
I farmed it several nights.
You did? Yeah. So did you start doing just the burn the bosses down and get it done as fast as possible?
Well, first I think I got really lucky. The first I ran it six times and I got all three weapons, the exotics. So wow. I was pretty stoked
about
that.
Yeah, those are dropping like crazy, yeah.
Yeah, but I've heard of people farming it all day and not getting any. So I don't know. I guess it's just
RNG. Yeah, I didn't get any.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I finally got the Queensbreaker bow, finally. I did get that to drop.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
What light? So,
319, I think, actually.
Okay.
319. But I was setting it. That was one of the first few things I did, and I was setting it like 315, maybe 317. So, yeah.
Yeah, so I did the challenge a total of, I want to say, five times for the actual challenge sigil between two characters. So I did that on two different guys. And then I went in like three times just to farm bosses.
Mm-hmm.
And out of those three times, I got not one single exotic.
Wow.
So I was like, well, this is bunk. This is not fun.
Wow.
Yeah. So but I mean, like the guys I was with were getting them. I'm like, well, what am I doing wrong here?
Yeah.
So I don't know. It just wasn't working for me.
I had read, and I feel like it was a credible source, not just like randomly a post on Reddit, but I had read that exotic engrams can drop from the three bosses in Challenge of Elders. I can't confirm it that that's true or not, but I can say that I was popping three of coins it felt like, and if you tell me if you guys felt the same this past week, even in Crucible, exotic engrams were dropping for me way more often than normal. And I was popping three of coins, but normally it takes 7 to 10 three of coins before they'll drop again. I played one Crucible game. I had several, I think, drop for me in Challenge of Elders, running it three times, at least a couple. And then I ran a Crucible match, went to the tower, and then jumped back in a Crucible match. And my visit to the tower was probably 5 minutes, maybe. And I popped a three of coins each start, the start of each Crucible game. And I got an engram, an exotic engram from both games.
I think I got about seven this week.
From
doing everything. I'm pretty sure, unless my brain's not working, I'm pretty sure I got one from Challenge of Elders, from killing one of the bosses.
And were you popping three of coins?
From three of coins, yes.
From three
of
coins, okay.
Yeah, I have a three of coins going all the time, so.
Right. Yeah,
I've had a total 50. Of two all week.
Wow, man.
Yeah.
Dude, I can.
Lackluster right now.
Yeah, my RNG was really poor. I mean, this is something we'll talk about later, but like by last night, I'm looking at people and I'm seeing like high 330s. And I played everything I could play within the time that I had, like always trying to advance. And the best drop I had was 329. And everything else I got was like 326 and below. Like I was just not advancing as far as other people. And a lot of people were doing it was just farming exotics from as far as I know. And I can't get them to drop. So I don't know what to do. It's all good though. I'm not in a rush, but it's just interesting like how different the experience is between people. You know,
mm-hmm. I started with my characters at like 319, 320. Mm-hmm. And the highest that I have is my warlock at 324. So I've been collecting a lot of exotic engrams, but I'm not cracking any of them. I kind of wanted to just kind of let it come naturally.
Oh, nice. So you're saving them up.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's way smart. When I get to like the 330 mark around there and when I crack them open, then they'll be, you know, mm-hmm. between there and 335. So
yeah that's smart. I opened up the two that I had because I wanted to see what I could pull out and see if it would help me move up a little bit. So, and of course I run warlocks and we don't have boots, so I got radiant dance machines at 324. I was like, well, I guess I'll infuse these into something. I don't know.
Well, let's talk about real quick, because we definitely need to talk about the rewards and the light level and the smart loot. Before we hash that out, real quick, what did you guys get a chance to play the Winter's Run redone, taken version?
Man, no. I couldn't get that one to launch for me. I tried for about 30 minutes one night before I was getting ready for a raid. Couldn't get it to show up. I'm going to try again maybe some tonight and see if I can get it. I've heard it's very difficult.
Yeah, well, I launched my very first heroic strike, and it was that. And I think I think it was the only one that I did. And I realized what it was. It took me a minute after it loaded in. And the rando fire team I was with did the old school run through everything. They didn't fight.
Oh, really?
All they fought was the one room that you have to wait for the door to open. So I just ran with them. And that part didn't seem, you know, as easy as before. But I will mm-hmm. say that the boss fight, it is weird because I'm sitting there waiting for the Archon Priest to come out of the ship, you know, or the cell or whatever. And all of a sudden, the boss just appears right there, like right there in the middle. And then, and I heard someone else talking about this on another podcast, but he kind of just, we fought him for a little bit and he was kind of over by us, where you hide, you know, the way that you go into that little section of the strike. And mm-hmm. then he went all the way over to the other side and just kind of stayed over there and walked around like in a circle. So we just sniped him from across the way. But maybe that was just that particular instance of it. But I mean, it's fun to be back in that strike. That was always a fun strike to run. But
yeah.
I've never understood why they retire all the old stuff, you know. It just doesn't make sense. I think integrating it all together, it's right. good. So I'm glad that they've kind of brought this back.
Well, I thought about that again today. It just kind of hit me again today. I'm like, I really think maybe they're saving, and they'll probably, if it's not a lot of content to go with it, they'll get slammed for it. Who knows? But there is no way that those old raids aren't. I feel like they're saving it for a massive drop for later down the road, because I completely agree with you. We won't go down that road, but I just feel like it's a matter of time before they've got to do that. But anyways, sorry. I agree, Manny. I agree.
Everybody's on that bandwagon, man.
Yeah.
Update the old raids.
Yep.
I'm with you. No, but I'm going to try to play that one tonight, because I really wanted to check it out. It seemed like fun. I do like that strike, and I want to see the differences there. And plus, that particular strike drops the Taken weapons, right?
I believe yes. so. Yes.
Yeah. So that's why I really want to get at it, man. I want to see some of those. Yeah, this could be fun. And I know that he can drop up to 335 stuff. So
right.
Yeah. Another reason. So I ran a bunch of heroic strikes this week trying to get that to play, and I was just like, well, I guess I'll go kill Omnigol. Try to get that bond still that I haven't got, you know. Killed her like four times.
Still no bond.
Yep, still no bond.
Your RNG, man, it's going to turn around. I didn't realize it was this rough for you right now.
It's not terrible. I mean, I got some cool stuff. Like, I got some good legendary stuff. Like, I progressed some this week. I'm right. spoiled. I want everything right now. You know,
right?
Yeah, it goes.
Well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about, first and foremost, what do you guys think of the one-to-one infusion that we have now? Manny, what do you think, dude?
Dude, it's awesome. It's more than a quality of life change, because it's, you know, I have, like, I still need to clear out my bank, but I have so much junk in there that I was holding just to infuse things, like at certain breakpoints, you know, you got to get to this number to get to this number, you know. Now that that's gone, I feel free to use everything that I get, because I know it's not going to take much to get it to a strong power level. So, I think it's great. I think it's awesome.
Well, Cyborg, you grinded to hit, you actually hit 320. You did it the hard way. So this probably seems like a breeze, huh?
It's, well, you know, it was good pushing past that light level. You know, a lot like Manny, if you play with me a lot, you know, I spend hours and hours combing through my vault and clearing it out when it gets full, because I keep everything for infusion fuel. I'm like, well, you know, no, I don't need this 313 shotgun, but I'll keep it in case I get a good special that I want to raise up or something. And it just sits in there for, you know, weeks and weeks and weeks. So I also have to clear out a lot of stuff, but I'm kind of, I don't know. I'm kind of stuck with a lot of the new stuff I got that's, you know, above 320, because on one hand, I want to keep the new stuff, you know, because I don't know what all I'm going to get. And I don't know if one thing is better than the other yet. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I'm getting new stuff, but I don't want to use it to raise up the old light stuff, because, well, this is the new stuff and it could be better. I don't really know. I don't have enough stuff yet. Is that a bad problem? So that's like funny. I've got all this new stuff, but I refuse to infuse it into anything, and I'm kind of paralyzed. But I'm sure, you know, by this time next week, I'll have more goodies, and I'll start figuring out what my favorite items are and what I like and I don't like, and you know, you'll start to get duplicates of stuff, and you'll get a better thing. So I'll slowly but surely clear things out, you know, get rid of all the junk that I have, but. Overall, it's great, because you don't have to give up as much to play with something that you like. So there's less of a barrier there if you have this, you know, 280 exotic that you just bought from Xur, and you bring it out and you love it. you know, if you've got the piece, you can just immediately raise it up to 320 or 325 or whatever and bring it to that in-game activity that you like, whether it's trials or PoE or the raid or whatever it is. And you don't need, you know, three pieces in between that to bring it up and like five exotic shards and all this stuff. And so that's cool. But on the other hand, it's making me wonder, like, does it make things too fast?
Right.
Because I was playing with somebody last night and she already had her warlock up to like 334.
Oh, wow. I was like,
what have you been doing all week? Like, holy crap. Like, how are you there?
Well, see, for me, the infusion, like, I still am trying to wrap my head around it because I'll get something and I'll, just for a split second, I'll think the old way and I'm like, oh, I mean, that's pretty high light. And then I'm like, wait a second. I can instantly infuse whatever I want right up to that point. And then you take that on top of probably what you were mentioning, her being all the way up to 334, the smart loot now across all activities and engrams and everything. They have a chance to drop anywhere from, what is it, like 3 to 5 light higher than what you are, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, if you, from what I understand, well, this happened to me. I had a shotgun that I was running. Yes, a shotgun. I'll talk about my new loadout in a little bit. But I had a shotgun that was at 304 light. It was by far the lowest light thing that I had. And I'm like, man, I really want something to infuse into that so I can get my light back up a little bit. And I opened a package from the Crucible vendor and got a 325, 326 fusion rifle. And from what I understand, the game not only will give you something 3 to 5 light higher, but it has a chance to give you possibly the what you need that is the lowest light thing that you have. Is what I've heard. I can't confirm that, but it worked for me. I mean, I had all the different things that I could have gotten, and I got a special weapon that would infuse into my shotgun. Now, with that said, you can even play this more strategically. I'm sure you guys have heard this talked about. You can get real specific with it, of course. And if the lowest light thing you have, say, is your special weapon and you have a special weapon engram, you'll want to do that first and do it the smart way, right? Kind of like we did old school.
Yeah.
Where you infuse each piece up, one each lower piece up one time, one at a time, right?
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Put on your best stuff and, you know, decode those one at a time and make sure you get the highest light you can when you get engrams, and you got to play that whole game, man.
But it's so crazy to me. Like, we were talking about this earlier today, Cyborg, with reaching 335. And to me, I feel like it is like you were mentioning, it's kind of awesome and it's kind of not awesome, because if you really hunt for that max level, like we have on a lot of these updates that they've dropped in DLC. But in addition to that, how much they've added to the quality of life and the rewards we're getting in the game right now, and the smart loot across all the way to, I ran a tier 3 Court of Oryx, and I got, you can get the artifact from there. And it was one of the first few things that I ran, and it was like 3 or 4 light higher than what I had. It's so great to be able to do so many different things and get something that will help you increase your light to reach max and to do whatever you need to do.
Yeah, it is fun to not only go back and play stuff that I'd pretty much retired, like Court of Oryx, and I'm really upset that I deleted like 10 to 15 antiquated runes not long ago.
Yeah, me too, man.
I was like, I'm never going to need these. Why am I keeping these? And then now I'm like, oh, I want all my antiquated runes back.
I know. When I went to it, I was like, do I have one? And I stepped up and I got the little icon. So I was like, sweet, I can do it.
Yeah, but no, it is fun to be able to mix it up. You know, I've played more of a variety of activities this week than I have in months, you know? And I like that. I like being able to jump in and do lots of different things. And a lot of the things are like bite size. So you can go here, go there, string this. Oh, anybody want to do this? Okay, cool. Yeah, I'll go run this strike or, you know, there's just lots of different stuff to do. And they've built, you know, a good kind of stable of bite size activities that you can jump in now and have updated them all enough to make them relevant. So, you know, with adding PoE into that mix, two different types of PoE, like I feel like there's more to do now than there's ever been. Maybe not all of it is brand new, but there's a lot of variety and I like that.
We've been like, people have been asking for this for a long time, right? Especially people that mostly play PvP. Cause you know, you go to the lighthouse and you want to get to max light, but you just can't cause you don't get the drops you need. So, I mean, this is great. You know, having like over a dozen ways to get to max light is something the community has been asking for a long time. So this is great.
Man, I will get in. I am so excited about what's happened with trials, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Right. I want you guys both, let's hit right on this question because you were mentioning this earlier, Cyborg. So 335, it's still going to be a bit of a grind. I know, we do know that somebody did hit max light in like 3 or 4 hours because they saved a bunch of exotic engrams and they did the whole smart decrypting and all that. Yeah. Actually, I think he was on, I'm sorry, I don't remember his name, but I think he was on Fireteam Chat this week, IGN's Destiny podcast. He hit it in like 3 or 4 hours. He hit max light.
Jeez.
He had some really crazy lucky loot drops, though, from the raid. Like, he got a cloak right when he needed it, different things like that. But even though it's going to take a few weeks, so Cyborg, your question was, and we'll throw it at Manny and see what he thinks. We're going to get to 335 a lot faster and easier than Cyborg got to 320. Do you think they've added enough quality of life stuff to the game and enough rewards and things like that and just reasons to come back that max light isn't going to be all that we're hunting?
Well, we got to put it all into perspective. This is a free update that we've been given just by owning the Taken King. So, I mean, they could have made it a grind to where it takes somebody who plays 20 hours a week, several weeks to get. They could have made it up to like 365 or whatever. They wanted to give us something for the spring that was going to be fun, that's going to take the average person, you know, several weeks to achieve. And I mean, you know, let's face it, we are not the average player. We are the hardcore player. We play, you know, I played The Division a little bit when it came out and I was stoked about that, had a good time. But a week before this update, I just jumped back into Destiny and I've played it every night since. And, you know, so putting everything into perspective, I think what we have here is fantastic, you know. So is it too easy to reach? I don't know. I don't think so. It's, you know, it's taken me all week to go from 320 to 324. So, and like, you know, I'm saving all my exotic engrams. So I'm sure if I cracked all those open, I'd be higher, but you know,
there's so many different pieces of gear you have to level.
Yeah.
But Cyborg, what do you think, man? We were talking about this earlier.
Well, it's kind of that question of, well, okay, once you hit 335, great. But at this point, it's not as if we're trying to reach that to be at the pinnacle of some activity, right?
Yeah.
True, so in the past, getting max level or max light or whatever was what enabled you to be the best at a raid or, you know, maybe even the top of PvP, but that damage curve is not as great there. But so now, you know, yeah, we want to do it to be competitive because sure, like in PvP, light level enabled activities, you want to be as high light as you can, but really it's just there for the sake of doing it. I can't really tell you a reason why you would need to be 335 right now.
I didn't really think about that part of it, man.
So once you do, if I had to name this update, I would call it the Collector's Update because everything that we're doing is all about getting a new edition of a gun that has these god roll perks, or, you know, getting this new taken armor that you want and putting together the whole set and raising the light up, or, you know, whatever. There's all this stuff to go out there and get and collect just for the sake of enriching your gameplay. Mm-hmm. There is no in-game activity. It's just the game. You're just doing it to enjoy the game more. But I like that. That's cool. Like, there's no pressure. It's just, hey, like, yeah, I want to get max light. Like, there's no rush. I want to get more stuff with higher light so I can pick what I want again. There's going to be a ton of different, you know, armor sets and with all the different perks and chroma. I mean, think about all the different variables they've added now. Mm-hmm. Now, not only do you want the new set, but you want the new set with the right chroma. You got to get the chroma. You know, there's all this different stuff. So I think it's cool. I think it's fun. And I think it'll keep people busy for longer than a month. I think it'll be 2-3 months before it really is kind of like, okay, I have everything now. I've literally got everything, you know?
Right. You know, it's interesting you say that, because I'm always by default, and I say always, I started this game out for the first 6 months playing nothing but PvE content, but I'm instantly kind of thinking of my PvP route, like what I'm going to do and where I'm going to get my gear and stuff. And I didn't think about, it's easy to forget, you know, if you play trials a lot like I do, if you hit 335, like you said, you're not really striving for that for any particular activity. But, you know, I'll just share, we'll jump into trials for a second. Like, mm-hmm. we ran 4 or 5 trials passages this weekend, and man, what they've done with the smart loot. So in trials now, I've been asking for this and wanting this for so long. Manny, you kind of mentioned it earlier. You get a random piece of armor and a random gun from the 5 and 7. It's not set. At least it wasn't this week. I assume that's the way it's going to be from now on.
Okay.
And it's smart loot. So you get something, whatever, 1, 2, or 3 to 5 light higher. So you get that at 5, you get that at 7, and then you get your bounties done. Those are smart loot. So you get something from the silver and the gold, probably.
Yeah.
And then if you get to the lighthouse, at least this week, all three of us got a piece of armor, and that includes marks and cloaks and bonds as armor, and a weapon. We got both with the smart loot getting to the lighthouse. So,
nice.
And it took like 4 or 5 passages, but we got to the lighthouse. Speaking of that, my new favorite, and I've mentioned this on Twitter, I absolutely love No Land Beyond Shotgun. It is like by far my new I ran it all weekend. I played around with the Hawksaw a little bit, the new vendor, amazingly rolled Hawksaw.
PvP. We'll talk about all these amazing gun rolls another episode. There's too much.
You're right, dude. I think you're right with it being the collector's update. Because I got to say, dude, like, they have so much so that I tweeted several of them about it. Like, they have hit something with this update as far as quality of life. Because I feel like I'm playing Diablo 3 2 years after it came out, and they patched it to what the community was asking for. Because, and I typed this up because this feeling I had to share this with you guys. When we hit 9-0 in trials, I got all that stuff I just told you. I went back to the tower. I had some stuff in my postmaster from the end of activity rewards from trials. I also had, we had our crucible buff activated for, the whole fire team, because you only have to do one of them. And then I had a crucible package waiting for me. I had a dead orbit package waiting for me. And I got all these rewards, dude. Like, I came back to the tower after running Trials of Osiris, one activity, and I felt like the game rewarded me so much.
That's awesome.
I've wanted it for so long from Trials, man. But I feel like it's doing it from, like, across the whole game.
Yeah. Everything I've done, I've felt like I've been rewarded. Like, I think, yeah, I did the hard mode raid 3 times this week, and you know, it was just showered with upgrades the entire time. You know, and it's mm-hmm. awesome. You know, it's really,
yeah,
it's like it's revitalized the game.
One thing they did I thought was cool that I saw in the actual patch notes was that they increased armor and weapon drop rates in Kingsfall normal and hard mode. So not only did they raise the possible light levels for those rewards, but they just completely buffed what you could get altogether. Mm-hmm. Like Golgoroth challenge, I counted like, I want to say 6 rewards from that challenge doing it on hard mode. So like, and I was getting like normal mode stuff dropping at 320. It was kind of cool. There was a bunch of stuff dropping when I did the raid. But no, I think it's great that you finally get your wish in Trials, man. Oh, man.
Yeah.
And I mean, I played Trials too, probably not as heavily as you do, but I will look forward to doing it, you know, soon in next weekend so that I can, you know, get some more rewards and progress. I actually had, and didn't realize it, I swapped to my other warlock and looked in his bounties and he had a gold tier bounty sitting there.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And I was like, oh, and I, so I saved it until I was about 322, I want to say. And I popped it and I got a 326 glass promontory, exact same stats as the one I've been using for the past like 2 months. I was like, oh yes. Mm-hmm. I was so excited, man.
Well, dude, I got enough. I actually even got enough of infusion fuel from playing my Titan all week that I infused everything up on my Hunter and got her up to like 320. Nice. I just feel like the game is just so rewarding right now. Like it's on a whole nother level right now. But
well, that's great, man. I'm glad everybody's feeling good about this. It's definitely been the most fun I've had in Destiny in a little while. And so if that's mm-hmm. their goal, I think they achieved that goal, you know.
Right.
My friends list was full of people playing Destiny again. Like, you know, first day I jump in, I'm like 3 pages full of players. I'm like, yeah, this is awesome. Everybody's back on again, you know?
Yeah. Manny, if I remember right, we were chatting, all of us, a little bit in Discord, and you weren't like, you were still digging the Division pre, like a couple weeks before this was coming out. And I mean, did it take you a little bit to get hyped up back for Destiny again? Cause like you said, you haven't not logged in one day since it dropped.
Yeah. Yeah. The Division, I don't know, man, that it's a fun game. It reminded me a lot of Diablo 3, and I was a hardcore Diablo player for a long time. So, but yeah, they just didn't have it all figured out. And I didn't want to get overly excited about what Bungie was doing, because I knew it was going to be a free update, and I thought, what are they going to give us that's free? I wanted a paid expansion, you know. Like, man, I've been completely surprised and blown away. I have like I've been collecting all these weapons for a long time. And I have just this huge list of stuff that I want to try, and I just don't have enough time to try it all. So, you know, if you look and see everything they've done, it's not a ton of stuff that they've done, but they've done it all right, at least from my perspective. And man, I look at my vault and I just see like months worth of stuff to play with. So,
right.
I don't know. Bungie's done really well with this for sure.
Mm-hmm. I agree, man.
I wanted to ask y'all one more thing before we wrapped up, because we kind of glossed over it real quick. But what did you guys think of Challenge of Elders in general? Did you enjoy that spin on that game mode? Because I really liked it. What did you think, Manny?
It's fun. It's fun. I mean, I like that it's a quick activity, so you don't have to commit like mm-hmm. a whole hour of your time. And it's, you know, that I think we're pretty lucky this week because it's small arms, right? So you just go in there with a scout and just tear it up. But you know, next week when it's like light switch and you need the modifier to get melee kills, it's going to be crazy. You know, it's going to be nuts. So because of all these modifiers and how they're going to change, I think we still have I challenge of elders. I think it can actually pose a challenge to us one of these weeks, depending on the modifiers. So the fact that it was so easy to blow through this week, it may not be that way next week. So, you know, that's what makes POE fun.
Yeah, I agree, man. I was more excited about POE. I've mentioned that before than Trials back when they were both announced. And I'm excited about Challenge of Elders. I can't wait for it to be a little more challenging. And I love that they added kind of a Trials-ish weekly bounty to it. I think that's going to add a lot to it.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I think the fact that they're, as opposed to going in and having to deal with different modifiers, you actually have an objective. So you actually have some kind of agency in, you know, getting in there and having fun doing a specific thing. And I just found that that particular thing about this activity to be enjoyable for me. I'm like, oh, okay, well, we're going to kill all the bad guys, but we have to kill them the right way. There's ways that you can stack it up. Like we're kind of figuring out, well, how do we maximize our point usage? You know, assists are great. So, you know, stand there together and pop a body shot while the guy gets the headshot, you know, get the extra points there. Or, you know, melee kills are more than like a gun kill. So for shanks, go and punch the shank rather than shoot it with your gun, and you get like four times as much points. And then if you generate orbs, you get points. So if you have like an artifact that'll give you a particular orb generation on killing a particular type of enemy with precision shot, for instance. So there's all these different ways. So I'm really interested to see, because they did say they curated what these modifiers and bosses are going to be. I'm kind of interested to see how far they're going to go with that, and how intricate these builds might have to be to maximize your points. You know, I'm looking forward to it. I think it's something I'll enjoy doing every week. So it was fun for me. I liked it.
Yeah, I almost feel like they should put the chest back at the end of Challenge of Elders, just because it's fun to go to the chest after you're done with.
Yeah. That's the only downside, is that warm fuzzy chest feeling.
Nice.
We before we wrap up the main topic, we had asked Twitter real quick what their thoughts and experiences were with the April update. Mr. @MitchShows, he loved loot drop frequency. POE is in game, the fusion buff, we'll talk about that another day, and the overall crucible balance were some of the things he liked.
Mm-hmm.
You want to catch some of these, Manny?
At EM Lore, aka Got Turkey, which is pretty sweet, one-to-one infusion, which we talked about, and that is awesome, definitely.
Yeah.
And at DD Comrade, my plan C has become my plan A.
Nice. Yeah, I hear that thing's pretty nasty right now. I need to get it out.
Yeah, I even saw a video of True Vanguard running around with that thing a little bit in one of his YouTube videos.
So
it's a beast. We also got one from @Mudlin Through. Story was too short, but nice to have something for free. I like the chroma also. You can put a little hashtag derp fam in there. And then we got from one from M, is that Martinet, I guess? Sorry if I totally messed that up. So far, loving the update. Lots of new gear and an easier to understand upgrade path, and so much loot. Sounds so like everybody's loot. Getting the loot, but Cyborg.
Yeah, you get. Well, yeah, that's cool. As long as somebody's getting it, I can live without
it's
it.
Coming.
I'll get mine. Don't worry. Yeah. Well, it was fun talking the update with you this week, guys, but now it's time to get into the Derp Fam feels.
Oh yeah.
Ready for the feels, Manny?
Bring it.
Can you handle the feels? Right.
Manny says bring the feels. We got a great speak pipe continuing on the speak pipe chain here. for Mr. Businessman 24. Let's take a listen.
It's business time.
Hey everyone, this is the businessman. Holding court, I accept your challenge. And I wanted to thank Arrow Knight and Cyborg Sasquatch for the podcast and for creating and fostering and nurturing such a great community as Derp Fam. It's not too long ago where I joined the clan on PlayStation, and you know, I didn't have any friends on the platform, and now I have plenty. I am always involved in the Discord. I'm always chatting up a storm, you know, making fun or doing funny things, whatever the case is. But it's been a really, really, truly a great experience to be part of a positive community such as the Derp Fam. I wish I can give a shout out to everyone, but I can't. So I'll give a shout out to a couple of people before I present my nomination. First shout out goes to No Pity for giving me the wonderful slogan, "It's business time." It's my phrase and I'm sticking to it. Holding court as usual for being superstar. Big Daddy Davis for showing me how to tighten semester class. and there's a bunch of others I would like to give a shout out to at this moment, but I can't. So right now I'm going to nominate, I know the suspense is killing you, Ben TB 42. Let's go, buddy. It's your time. It's business time. Check you all later.
Awesome. Speak pipe businessman calling out, continuing it on with Ben. You have been challenged, my friend. Will you continue the speak pipe challenge?
Man, this is great what Heavens and Aesthetic started. It's so fun to see who's next.
Yeah, it's business time.
So we got, as usual, as we love them all, whether it be SpeakPipe or email, we got several emails this week. To start off, we got one from Jacob, a.k.a. Jay Franzi, maybe? Franksy Skates. Email is so thankful on the subject. So he says, "Hey guys, just had to write a quick note to share how appreciative I was this evening with the Derp Fam. What an experience. I shot out a note in the Xbox One Discord channel asking if anyone would help me with getting the black spindle. Deadly Teddy shot a quick note back, was quickly willing to help. He hit me up with a friend and a fellow Derp Fam member, Danny the Kirk." We've heard old Danny before, and Deadly Teddy. "And we went to work," he says. "Both guys had already obtained the sweetness that is the black spindle and talked me through all the details. After our first failed attempt, we decided to give it another try, and we beat it with time to spare. My heart was pounding, and I kind of crapped my pants in excitement. Then both guys encouraged me to give Iron Banana a try, even though I am admittedly terrible at PvP. We ended up playing 10 rounds together, and other Derp Fam guys joined in. Shout out to the Matu, LethalBeat21, Lucky, help me there with that Roman numeral. That is that right? I don't think that's right. We'll just say what it is. It's Lucky XIIV. And Bolt Striker 6. We've heard a good old Bolt Striker before. All amazingly gracious, as I contributed very little to all our wins. I was blown away. Still am. Thanks for being awesome. Jake J. Franzi Skates on XB1. Thanks for your email. Actually, we always want to preface this with, we got this email a week or two ago. You guys are sending in so much love and so many feels that we're having to like push these out a few episodes ahead. So
yeah,
if some of the information, it seems a little irrelevant, please hang with us. We want to get all the feels in whenever we can.
We've got to get caught up on our feels here.
Yes, and please tweet me for not knowing that Roman numeral, and I'll be glad to say thank you.
Yeah. That's XIIV for those of you who want to correct Arrow Knight.
Please do.
All right.
If you're a warlock, though, if you're a warlock, don't worry about it. Don't tweet me. Cyborg,
we are the masters of knowledge. We got another email from Jason, a.k.a. J. Howard 414. Derp Fam shout-outs. He says, "Hey, Arrow and Cyborg. So keeping you guys unbiased, I would like to give a shout-out to none other than Arrow Knight himself for bringing me through my first try at Sweaty's Tuesday night. Even though my one kill, 41 deaths, will forever haunt me, I had a great time with the Derp fam. I know if I ever see Terry again, I will surely turn and run, screaming. Thanks for all the insight, dude. Derp fam always Jason, J Howard 414, and that's Howard with a zero.
He says that because Terry runs his warlock and sweats with firebolts, and he destroys.
Scary. Scary indeed.
All right, we got another one from... Oh, and thank you, by the way, Jay Howard. I appreciate it, man. Running sweats with you was super fun and awesome. We'll do it again sometime. You know what, Cyborg? If you have it in you, man,
you want to do this one?
You're the master at these longer emails. Go for it.
I do my best, man. All right. Mr. Matthew Frasher, with an F, I believe is how you pronounce this. And the subject is hashtag DerpFamFeels. And he says, Arrow and Cyborg, greetings from Nashville, Tennessee. I'm a relatively new member of the fam. My wife surprised me with a PS4 for Christmas, and I have to say that I owe her big time. After I discovered the podcast, I've been exposed to the awesome community you've built. I've played and laughed with tons of cool people, slayed lots of aliens, and saved the world countless times. Before I joined the Derp fam, I dabbled with LFG groups, and there simply is no comparison. The Derp fam is full of some of the most positive, down-to-earth guys and girls you'll find anywhere in gaming, and I am truly humbled to count myself among them. I can't thank you adequately for the amount of value that you add to this game. I always look forward to the show during my drive in the morning, and I always look forward to teabagging the War Priest with some of the Derp fam's finest after I get home in the evening. You guys have built something very special, and I'm sincerely thankful for the effort you and the admin team have dedicated to it. Through countless misadventures, suicides, and blown supers, the Derp fam has always been supportive and positive. So I want to give a special shout out to a few members of the fam that have made my short tenure here feel very welcome. These kind souls brought me into the fold and showed me the ropes, teaching me mechanics and displaying massive amounts of patience. So here we go. Saved Guy, The Berg, 012, The Businessman, 24, Honcho, _1, Holding Court, Milky Smash, 88, J Howard, 414, there he is, Bent B, _42, there's Ben, Baba Booey, 18, Colosta, WVU Avenger 26, and many, many more. Thank you for letting this noob get his chops up. It's an honor to play with you. It's an honor to be a part of the fam. May your loot drop plentifully and your rolls be godly. Regards, Matt, aka Kaku Machu, Titan Master Class.
I really just wanted you to read that very last little sentence there.
I didn't read the end part, otherwise I would have refused. But you got me. You got me. No, great email, Matt. You're so welcome to be here. I'm glad they got your chops up, man. Very, very glad for you.
Very good stuff, man. Familiar names. Guys holding down the Derp fam out there, welcoming the new guys.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And speaking of that, we got an email. We just wanted to throw out a general welcome to MSU James. He sent us an email asking how he could become a part of the Derp fam. I think we've since seen him in Discord and on the group wall. So thanks for the email and welcome to the Derp fam. We appreciate you listening to the show. Thank you so much, sir.
Well, yes.
The feels, man. Sorry if it takes a week or two, guys, but keep them coming.
Too much feels.
Keep them coming. We love it.
Manny, yeah, and send in those speak pipes.
Are you all right, Manny, after all those feels?
Dude, a lot of love, man. That's good.
Love the for Derp weeks. Fam love.
Can you feel the feels this show?
You do that in party chat, but I don't know that you've ever done that on the show. You have to do that.
I think it might have just flipped through.
Cyborg randomly just blurts out into song when you're in a party on Xbox.
I do.
Heads up for anyone part of who the plays fun. With them. Soon.
It's part of my charm.
Oh, yes. The Cyborg charm.
The Cyborg charm. Thank you, guys, for tuning in to Destiny Reset this week. I'm going to do your part, Arrow. Where can you find me? You can find me at Cyborg Sasquatch on Twitter. Where can they find you, Aero Knight?
You can find me at The Aeronight on Twitter and at Aeronight and Aeronight. I'm just kidding. On YouTube and Twitch. What about you, Manny? Where can they find
me? I can be found at AKA Manny G on everything. On Twitter, that's my gamer tag. Add me. And I do want to say, add me on Xbox. I may not be able to play with everybody, but I will do my best to try and hook you up with other Guardians to play with. And so, yeah, AKA Manny G.
Well, nice. Manny, I know we've said it on the show. I think we said it last time to you wonderful Destiny Reset admins. But, dude, thank you so much for all you do, man.
Oh, man, appreciate
you guys,
it.
You guys are the team we have and the fam in general, dude. It's just so great. It's such good stuff. So thank you, dude.
It's a huge privilege, and I feel pretty fortunate.
Good stuff. I think thank we've you, heard man. It through. We've heard it throughout, and we actually thank you to Coburn 1979, aka Zero Cruel, for giving us the iTunes review. Appreciate that. But he mentions in that review, the reason I bring this up, the Derp fam specifically. And that's huge, man. Like, what, just everybody keeping it real in the Derp fam, everybody staying positive, everybody adds so much value to this game, even in the dry spells. Like, it's just, it's so huge. So, good stuff.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah, before we forget, Aeronight, where can they find us on the web?
On the web, you can find us at DestinyResetPodcast.com. That will have links to our Facebook page, the YouTube channel where you can check out the episodes, the Bungie.net group link, and a link to email us if you want to email us some Derp fan feels. Don't forget also at Destiny Reset on Twitter. You're really throwing me off, man.
I know you did so good. I'm so proud of you.
I could just hear you breathing, listening to me.
Freaking
so, do you wait? Are you doing all this because you don't have a quote for us at the end of the show this week?
No, I have something different. Thank you for all the iTunes reviews, guys. It is always very kind of you. Coburn 1979, aka Zero Cruel on Xbox One. Thanks for the iTunes review, bro. Very nice of you.
You're throwing me off right now, dude.
Just let me have fun here.
Do it.
But anyways, guys, thanks for joining us again, Manny. And as always, have fun playing Destiny. Take care, Guardians. Now you do a quote.
Ooh.
How's it feel?
Man. That's nah,
it's okay,
stressful.
Dude. I'll just do a song.
Everybody gets up. It's time to stand now. We got a real jam going down. Welcome to the Derp Fam. Come on. Come on.
Amazing. Do the Derp it's my fam. New ringtone.
Manny, I'm glad you were here for this so you can see what I deal with every week.
Excellent.
And I'm not fading this out. I am not starting the fade out until right now.
Okay. Fade out.